Lord, shut up, for God's sake.
Actor. I mean, we were just talking, just saying, with the trying out for Boogie Nights.
Yeah.
How serious an actor are you?
You know, I'm not. I loved the idea of being an actor, and my son is an actor. My son says, "Dad, you know, like, there's a lot going on in your forehead, but not a lot going on behind the eyes sometimes." It's like, you know, so I don't think, you know, I think that part of me wanting to be an actor was me not wanting to be myself. And I'm, you know, I started out as a playing kids. You know, the loved one when I was 22, I'm playing a 13-year-old. And the chase, I was playing a 15-year-old when I was, you know, 23, whatever, 24. But I always said I was, you know, that I looked like a kid until you put me next to a real kid, then I looked like a kid with a hangover was the basic look, you know. I think I acted. You know, I think that at this point in my life, you know, I look at the body of work, and there's a couple things that I did that I thought were good. There's a lot of crap. I mean, if you see Still Alive, you get to see one of the crappiest death scenes ever filmed, me on Police Woman, you know. So I think that years later, at this point, several years ago, mm-hmm. I made a movie called Headless Body in a Topless Bar, where I played a guy named Carl Levin who was in a wheelchair, and I thought it was good work.
Was the movie any good?
It's a movie that nobody saw, but it was an interesting piece.
So were you kind of a coincidental actor? Was that the...
I had the chance to act a lot, and I think that the older I get, the more I look at that stuff and go, you weren't really as good as you thought you were.
But, would you like to go back and
I'd love to
do
act
better?
Oh, I'd love to. Yeah, I'd love to be in here doing it instead of out here trying to impress you. Because I think mm-hmm. I think that you know, the where my life is right now is more about what's going on.
And you started as an actor.
I started as an actor, yeah. I think that the best acting I did is probably as a songwriter in Ishtar. Mm-hmm. My most method work is writing for Chuck and Lyle, writing two very distinctly different mm-hmm. writing styles, and using my, you know, using method as a way to inhabit these actors and be their voice as the unseen songwriter that wrote their songs. I think that as an actor, I'm a pretty good songwriter.
So what was that experience like for you? I mean, was that hard? I mean, it got so killed before it even opened. And then it actually did business, which people don't ever want to remember about it.
You know, the hard part about it is that we did this full, it was originally supposed to end with cuts of their greatest hits album, mm-hmm. which we recorded. Michael James Jackson, who produced some of my early albums, mm-hmm. produced the soundtrack album for Ishtar that was never released. And we did mm-hmm. full-blown, hardcore rock and roll versions with great players. I mean, Lawrence mm-hmm. Jewell from Wings and you know, Craig Derge great musicians, mm-hmm. great rock and roll musicians, doing all these terrible songs that I wrote for Ishtar. And when the critics began to review the shooting schedule instead of the movie, Warren just was like, "No, we're not putting that out. We're mm-hmm. done here." You know, so.
So do you have a distance from that? I mean, I guess you were. I don't know if that was still the drug era or post.
That was the peak of my drug era. I mean, I actually, there's a scene where I had to write a scene where Warren and Dustin are crawling along in the desert dying, mm-hmm. and they're writing to keep from losing their minds. And I went out and mm-hmm. spent two nights in the desert in Morocco by myself just to experience it. And I come in out of the desert banging on Dustin's dressing room door and went, "Oh my God, it's like there's God out there. You don't even know what's out there. It's just, you know." And he was like, okay, all right. Yeah, I was pretty messed up in those days.
I don't know how you didn't end up doing Popeye too. It just it seemed to fit the whole thing.
Well, Harry did it. Harry Nilsson.
Brilliant songs in that movie.
Brilliant writer.
Yeah.
And a dear friend, you know.
So Stephen has dragged you into this now, what, 3.5-4 years ago? Is that?
I actually dragged him into it the very first time was May 2006, first time we ever shot together.
So 6 years together.
Yes.
How's the relationship going now?
You know, it's interesting because from where we started to where we are now, you can't get there from here, is that sort of thing. We wound up with this picture kind of You know, he made a film that kind of at times feels like the film made the relationship and all. I love the movie he made. I find it very difficult to watch at times, parts of it.
Somebody today emailed me and said, you know, I watched the first half hour of your movie and the DVD skipped, and you have to tell me how it ends up. And I said, well, how it ends up is I'm picking up Paul at the airport at 4:30. That's how it ends up.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly. And so, you know, airport runs, that's above and beyond.
I mean, you know,
it's true family.
You do movies and you form these kind of artificial family feelings quickly, right? And you know, most times it doesn't last, but it feels like for us it has lasted.
Yeah.
Maybe because I keep bothering him, that's how it feels, but that's how it feels.
And I think we'd actually like to do something together. We'd like to, you know, like to find something really fun to do.
We bicker sometimes.
We do, but when you're wrong.
It's not always like this.
When you're wrong, exactly. When you're wrong, we bicker.
We have a good communication.
So what's the experience been like for you? I mean, the movie's about you. It's about you not getting enough attention. Obviously, it's giving you more attention.
Yeah.
Do you really feel it, or is it?
Well, that was my concern. Is that my bumper sticker line is there's nothing more pathetic in this world than some little old man going, please, sir, may I have some more attention? Can I have that camera back on me again? And it's the last thing I wanted. You know, I just, you know, I was seriously addicted to the attention I was getting. And that addiction, you know, as I say in the film, as I say in life, to be different is difficult. To be special is addicting. And it was for me. And I think that my love affair with, you know, with being in the public eye and being a star, being a celebrity, really got in the way of my craft. I mean, I don't think that during the late, so you go to the 80s, the point when I was doing anything anybody ever wanted me to do, I don't think that my craft as a songwriter developed. I don't think that, I think I became better at showing off than showing out. Is the best way to put it. And so I probably would have stayed there until nobody wanted to have anything to do with me if I hadn't fallen in love with, developed another addiction that was even greater, and that was cocaine and vodka. My addiction to drugs and alcohol and other drugs outran my addiction to the camera and to the attention I was getting. So I was, rather than showing up for anything that I could get cast in or be on television in, I was just home peeking out the Venetian blinds looking at the tree police that were out there. I knew they're out there. They'd come to get me. You know, so I went away. You know, when I got sober, by the time I got sober, the career that I thought I had, it wasn't even a matter of, do you know who I used to be? It was, do you know who I used to think I was? It was one step even further removed. But so I didn't want to go poke the bear again. I didn't want to go and do this, but I have been.
So people think of you fondly, don't they? I mean, I assume there's a whole generation like Steven and like myself who remembers all of that stuff and kind of.
You know, actually, what's. Did you see someone held up a sign that said, I love your movie? You know what we love, you know, seeing that person again? We're at my agent's office. So what would be nice is, I have a meeting for you. That's the sign you want to see.
We have a check.
But anyway, the amazing thing is, from the time we premiered the movie at Toronto, which was September 2011, the press, people have been so, nobody's been to Paul like, what have you been doing all these years? Everyone's just like, hey, Paul, nice to see you. Like family and like friends and like someone they've grown up with. And that, I think, has been really there. You know, you use the word kindness. The kindness of people has really been extraordinary all over the world.
Yeah. You know, it was one of the things I was concerned about was that he was going to spend all this time making a movie and people would go, who cares? Who cares, you know? As a matter of fact, I think I actually say in the movie, who cares?
Yes.
Who cares about Paul Lance?
And it is, you know, it's funny because it is hard. You were saying before, it is hard getting people to see this film sometimes, to explain to them what this film is. It's not what their expectations is, which is like something you'd see on TV about someone who used to be famous and isn't anymore. But it's about so much, really, because he's about so much more than that.
But the other thing is that there is a device/divisiveness in the film, in the process of his, the choices where he would ask, and he would sit and ask lovely, wonderful questions for hours. Those questions.
You mean that
not,
we don't get along with each
wind
other?
Up, did
film.
Not wind up. Let me finish my thought here. This once.
All right.
He would ask these wonderful questions that did not wind up in the movie.
Right.
But where there are great moments where he will ask something just out of the blue that just pisses me off. That it just how dare, why would you ask that? And there was such insight to who I was and our relationship in that stuff, and that he, you know, and I'm saying to him, you put that in the movie, and he did. And I think that's the brilliance of what he chose to do as a filmmaker, because what you get to see is out of that tension and out of the resolution of that. That you know, relationship being torn apart and put back together, you get people, to find out who I am and who he is.
Yeah, I mean, people know that the movie is real because nothing's hidden. The microphones aren't hidden. The tension between us, the fact that he doesn't want me to be there, that's not hidden. And the way he kind of comes to trust me and tolerate me being around is kind of what makes the movie illuminating about who Paul is and how, what role recovery has played in his life, and also just kind of this very centered quality that his life has, that kind of when I was making the movie my life didn't have, and that's what was kind of really interesting to me.
Well, it's interesting that you really are a kind of the last generation of celebrity where there was an intimacy to it, I think, with the audience. I mean, now with the Kardashians and everything else, it doesn't feel the same way. Everything is kind of ephemeral, and it comes 1 minute, it's gone
it
the next second, literally and figuratively.
I think that my connection to the audience was that I was like one of them making it. I think they were. It was kind of, I stepped up out of that, you know, out of that weird little bunch of different people out there from the Midwest, and stepped up and sat down next to Johnny. And that's what they were. You know, they responded to the songs in a totally different way. They responded to the art, you know, through the brilliant people that recorded the songs, to the great performances of the Karen Carpenters and the Streisands and the, you know, the people that sang my songs. So I had that success, and that was what opened up the door for my being there. But I think the response from the audience was based on me being kind of broken like they were, or kind of mongrelly, like I don't know if I can find a word for it without insulting the audience, but I think there was some way that they were happy for my success. And I think, you know, that you know, when I met my wife, she said, Mariana, I had a great moment. She said, I knew that I loved you when I heard you on The Tonight Show one time describe yourself as a cross between Oscar Levant and Donny Osmond. And I went, God, I'd forgotten I said that. I mean, you remember that. There was something in that, something in my humor, something in my wit, something in the acerbic element of the wit that was to balance out the Hallmark Cards lyrics I was cranking out, you know.
And you know it's weird that I mean, now, ostensibly, there are things that are supposed to bring you closer to the star, like Twitter. Like, you could Twitter your favorite star, and they might Twitter you back. But there's also...
And Paul is now on Twitter.
But he is, but there's also a falseness to it, and a, you know, when the Kardashians go out in public, they've already called the publicist and everything. There's a phoniness and a rehearsed quality to it that when Paul was going on The Tonight Show, it wasn't like that. You knew that was the real guy.
Mm.
And you had that connection with entertainers that you're right. People don't have them. This, or maybe I'm just getting a little gray and I don't realize it.
No, I think it's real. I think the whole dynamic of it has changed. That the system, there's so much now grist for the mill that the bar for what you're attracted to has changed. And even on the talk shows, I mean, literally, they're processing, you know, which movie's opening next week more than they are having those characters on that they really like and have on every week. I mean, when Letterman went to 11:30, he stopped having on all that group of people who everybody loved. But you've never seen it again. You know, Fran Lebowitz, I think, has done 2 spots in 10 years, 15 years, or 20 years, whatever he's been on CBS.
Yeah.
And it just isn't the same. And Johnny did have on people who you were kind of just happy to see and didn't necessarily have something to sell.
Yeah. The crop of talking heads, even on news television, that as opposed to watching the news, you're watching people talk about again and again and again and again and again what's going on. So reality television has certainly made the life of these professional writer, a little smaller life in some ways.
You know? Of course, the strange dichotomy of the film is that you were lit up during a lot of those spots on Carson.
Oh, we all were.
And not happy about it. And now, you know, it seems like it's
interesting because, alcoholism is a progressive disease. There are places back in the 70s where we were all having a drink once in a while, and I wasn't over the line with it, you know. But then there are those places in the 80s when I just, I'm fried on cocaine, on Merv Griffin, or, I remember going over to shoot a Hawaii Five-O. That I actually wrote the story called Stringer. And I went over, and Jack Lord was really upset because I was drinking beer on the set, and I was like, "Why? What an ass! What does he think? I'm an alcoholic?" Well, turns out that perhaps Mr. Lord was insightful in his observation. Unfortunately, he's not around for me to make a proper amends to anymore. But I try to amend my behavior in his name.
And your life continues with ASCAP and all the work you're doing.
Yeah, I'm passionate about two things. I'm really passionate about recovery. I'm really passionate about music creators' rights and about all creators' rights. I mean, ASCAP is a performing rights organization. When radio plays music, which the kids get to listen to, from the world gets to listen to for free, if it's an AM station or FM station. There's money made by that free music being played because the advertising is sold. ASCAP gets a small percentage of that advertising and makes sure the writers that are being songs that are being played are paid. We have now fought to have that, as we went through radio and television and cable, people long before me fought for all those fights to make sure everybody got paid. It's something that I'm wonderfully passionate about. Pandora, exactly.
There was a big article in the Wall Street Journal yesterday, I think it was, about the fight over Pandora and whether, they're going to reduce their rates.
It's a negotiation underway. I'm sure we'll work it out.
And do you feel...
Absolutely.
Do you feel the hand of the movie as you wander through this world these days?
It's lovely. I mean, it's really lovely to be walking through the airport and have somebody go, I saw the doc, loved it, loved the doc.
Yeah.
Doc is funny, love this song. I go, oh my God.
Yeah, I got an email from Taiwan this week from somebody who saw it at a film festival there. And it's mind-blowing.
Yeah.
Right? That someone would see it and relate to Paul's story and relate to the popular culture of America. And
yeah, it's lovely.
Yeah, it's been wonderful.
And now is this the wrap up? Are we getting to the end of the journey as such, as we're getting to another award season?
Oh, at this point, well, we're not ready to say goodbye. We'll, as somebody once said, we'll burn that bridge when we get to it.
Yeah, Paul wrote a really great song that's at the end of the movie. When I called the film Paul William Still Alive and I told him I was gonna call him that, he said to me, "No, you're not calling it that."
I hated that.
No. And then finally he said, "If I write a song called Still Alive, I think it would be okay." And he wrote really a very beautiful, personal song, and maybe something with awards will happen with that, but I mean from my point of view, you can't make a film about a guy who had all these things and won all these awards and they did nothing for his long-term personal happiness and really, really care about that the same way. So my feeling about this film is it's really going to have a wonderfully long life as people discover it and see it, and it's great that people could pick it up on iTunes or Amazon or wherever they want to now, right? You can look under a rock and find a movie.
See, for me, the success of the film is to hear him say something like that, that the process of making the film has changed Steve Kessler. To the point where I think...
But Vegas Vacation changed me also, but...
In a different way.
It made me not go to Vegas so much anymore.
Exactly, and I'm still playing there, but you'll come and you'll shoot. For the DVD, we'll shoot extra stuff.
But I don't need to...
But I think
step on
that the values that he's talking about, where you realize that this, having that award, or this, is if celebrity and I mean, obviously, when your peers recognize your work, it's fantastic. You know, I mean, I'm in the Songwriter Hall of Fame. That was an amazing evening for me. You know, and when I walk on stage, they say, you know, Oscar, Grammy, Golden Globe winning Hall of Fame songwriter, and I go, you know what? That's a sentence that took me a lifetime to put together, and all. I'm proud of that. But that's not. There's no happiness in that. Happiness is in the process, and you know, it's like happiness for me is I went and spoke to U.S. Trade a couple of weeks ago about affairs in Russia. Mm. You know, I were in China rather. I was I testified at a hearing, a Senate hearing, on affairs with China, whether or not China should be or Russia should be allowed into the WTO, and get normalized, you know, trade relations. I mean, for an old drunk. You know, 22 years sober now, for an old drunk to be sitting down and, you know, testifying at a Senate hearing is an amazing testimony to, not to me, but to the recovery process and how successfully it works. And that's what's key to me. And I think that the picture at the very end has a wonderful message about recovery that is the most important part of the film to me. I love the old stuff.
Not to me, but to you.
Oh, I know,
you love
but to
the
me, exactly.
Stuff.
To me, it's important. You like all the, you know, the frontal nudity.
I love the funny
he
stuff.
He loves the full frontal nudity, just knocks him out. He spent so much time in the editing room with that footage of me naked. It's just...
And do you, what is your relationship with the songs themselves at this point?
Yeah, it's interesting. I wrote about a lot of stuff that I didn't feel until recently. It's where you like it. There's a lot of. I mean, I wrote a song called "Time." Time was a friend of mine back when I was young, and summer was forever. I wrote when I was young. What the hell? I mean, why? It's like some of the songs I listen to, and it's like time travel.
That's an incredible lyric. What album? Where was that?
Time. Time was a friend of mine back when I was young and summer was forever. Time, good was your first name. Every day a lesson was something new to learn. It was on an album called Someday Man, Roger Nichols and I. Mm. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
but you said before, though, you found, you know, some of your lyrics, I don't know what phrase you used. I don't want to use bad phrase.
Codependent anthems, I referred to them. You know, all the Ouch Mommy songs, Pick Me Up and Love Me. I spoke at a...
But they're so warm. They're so, like, they're still very lovable.
I spoke at a big recovery convention where I was one of the speakers, and Melody Beatty, who wrote Codependent No More, was in another building, or in a building right next to me. And I thought, wow, when worlds collaborate me. I wrote You and Me Against the World, which is not a really healthy thought when you think about it. You know, I won't last a day without you. Same deal, not a healthy thought. Mm-hmm. And in the next room is the woman who wrote Codependent No More. I wrote all those codependent anthem. So it's like you look at them, but something in people's neediness is touched by those lyrics, I guess, and I'm grateful for that.
I always wonder how it could have been that me at 11 hearing the lines, day after day I face a world of strangers where I don't belong, I'm not that strong, like that spoke to me as an 11-year-old kid.
Well, there's something perfect about the combination of Karen Carpenter and the lyric and the whole thing
is
just completely magical. Yeah. But those lyrics, I mean, again, that's the, you were kind of at the end of that era where people really remembered lyrics.
It was, and I write in American, I don't write in English. I mean, I wrote the way people talk, I think. And I wasn't good enough to write as clever as I mean, later on I got clever and none of those songs were hits. When I got, I wrote really great stuff later on and it's in a drawer somewhere. Mm-hmm. But when I just wrote what was going, when I wrote Authentic Need, when I wrote what was going on in the center of my chest, people responded, and I think that that's what they get in the film. They get authenticity in our relationship, and him taking me back through some stuff that is hard for me to watch, and asking questions about celebrity that I think are really key these days. You know, like he asked, you know, why I was always out there instead, you know. Paul Simon is on Saturday Night Live, but for the most part, he's writing his brilliant songs, and I'm doing the Gong Show, and I hated when he asked me that, but it's a valid question, because it addresses something that I was embracing as something that made me feel complete and whole and wonderful, and that was being.
But you know,
famous.
I don't know. It's funny. Maybe that's part of the reason I connect with you. But I don't know that I wouldn't have also taken the chance to be on the Gong Show. And also, if you that was what I mean, I liked that you were on the Gong Show.
Yeah, I know.
That was cool.
It wasn't until we made the film that you would go, but how did it wind up you? How did
well, that's what I was thinking
about. Simon,
but I saw that film on opening weekend.
All of that footage just makes me crazy. It makes me want to grab him by the throat, but he's so big he'd hurt me. Except he loves me.
So, but do you think you were just sucked into the wrong place at the wrong time, or the right place at the right time?
And no, I just had way too much fun. You know, it's like when you write a song and the first time that young lady tilts her head and goes, "Ah, you know, your life has changed." There's something about the audience response where you go, "Oh my God, they're connecting to what I'm doing." Mm-hmm. And if you have been needy and lonely and not had a date and going home alone for 26 years and you pick up a guitar and you start writing songs and then next thing you know it's 4 years later and people are stopping you on the street and saying, "I love what you do. I saw you on the Tonight Show last night." It's intoxicating. It's addicting. And it is addressing a need that is in all of us to be validated, to be loved, to be told, "You're funny, you're special, yeah, I love your songs," whatever. Mm-hmm. I just, you know, I was getting a meal that I had been denied for 26 years, and I ate way too much.
And did any of it feel other from that experience? I mean, was any of the stuff that...
Oh, fabulous memories of it. I mean, when Orson Welles hosted the Tonight Show, he asked for the three guests that were on the show. He asked for George Gobel, Flip Wilson, and myself. I mean, to have the memory of like, I mean, I wrote a special lyric to "You and Me Against the World" for Orson Welles. Orson Welles against the world. An even match, I'd call it Welles against the world. You know, and when one of you is gone and two are left behind to carry on. You know. Magic that would mystify you. Joseph Cotton's Jedediah, Welles against the world. I mean, I went out and had dinner with Orson Welles that night, and I'll never forget that. I mean, it's just, you know, I was good friends with Robert Mitchum. I mean, I would never have met Robert Mitchum if I hadn't had the public persona and the success that I did.
And if you weren't drinking.
And if
probably,
I was what?
And probably if you weren't drinking.
And I wasn't drinking. Well, exactly. Oh, so I saw him once sober, and he looked at me like a turncoat. Like, yeah. He used to call me Doughboy. He'd go, "Doughboy, this shit's no good, but you might like it." And I'd try it and cross your eyes. You know. But he looked at me like, "Doughboy, what happened to you?"
That's incredible.
Yeah.
When I was 22, somebody once said to me that I could drink with Mitchum. Somebody who used to drink with Mitchum said, "You know, you could drink with Mitchum," and I like took it as such a compliment. And wow. I stopped drinking soon thereafter, but it was that was a bad week.
Yeah,
we were doing a lot back then.
Yeah,
but I was still young enough to get away with it, I guess.
Yeah.
So now are you still writing often? Or
I am. I'm writing. I'm actually writing right now. Working on a co-writing a proposal for a book on basically on recovery. So.
But songwriting?
Pardon?
Songwriting?
No, recovery. Songwriting?
No, but I mean songwriting in general. Are you doing?
Oh, absolutely writing right now on a big album that's going to be out in the spring, and I can't talk about it. There's a lockdown. I can tell you as soon as we turn off the camera, I'll tell you who I'm writing with, but I can't. I can't tell you.
But you're stretching the muscles.
Oh, absolutely stretching those muscles. As a matter of fact, I'm a guest artist on an album that's going to be very, very exciting for people to hear, and I'm very proud of it. And it's really frustrating that part of the deal is I can't talk about it.
Well, it's all better when Christmas morning comes, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
You get to share it together. And the odd couple here will live on?
Yeah.
We'll occasionally
eat some squid.
Go to the park, sit and
he'll take me for my walk. He'll take me for my walk. "Come on, Paulie, get your walker. We're going to take you out tonight, little guy." "I don't want to go out tonight. I want to stay home and watch reruns of...
Of me.
Of me.
Am I on? Find
well,
me.
I'm actually going to write it. At some point, I'll write my biography, and the title of it is going to be, "Am I in Town?" Oh, yes.